We begin with the president pushing to widen the circle of opportunity in this nation, and to that end, calling today for a one-year extension of the Bush tax cuts for those earning less than $250,000 a year. And his push to extend only the middle-class cuts picks a fight over the so-called fiscal cliff, with all the tax cuts currently set to expire at the end of this year. And clearly aware of the optics, the president made the announcement this afternoon, surrounded by workers and families who'd benefit directly if those rates were extended.
I'm not proposing anything radical here. I just believe that anybody making over $250,000 a year should go back to the income tax rates we were paying under Bill Clinton. Back when our economy created nearly 23 million new jobs, the biggest budget surplus in history, and plenty of millionaires to boot.
The president naturally predicted the response of one multimillionaire in particular as he smacked down the Republicans' cry that all the tax cuts must be extended.
We've tried it their way. It didn't work. The wealthy got wealthier, but most Americans struggled. So we don't need more top-down economics. We've tried that theory. We've seen what happens.
Speaking of which, Mitt Romney was busy enjoying the rarefied airs in Aspen, Colorado. More on that in a moment. But he did respond to the move in a radio interview on the John Fredericks Show.
What the president's proposing is therefore a massive tax increase on job creators and on small business. Small businesses are overwhelmingly being taxed, not at a corporate rate, but at the individual tax rate. That will be another kick in the gut to the middle class in America.
Right, so a tax cut is another kick in the gut for the middle class. Okay, if you say so, Mr. Romney, but the president did pick a choice moment with today's statement, just as Mitt Romney and friends seem to be staging their very own version of Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. Today, Mr. Romney is taking his gilded caravan up to Aspen for several high-dollar fundraisers after leaving behind his week-long vacation at his lakeside estate to hobnob in the Hamptons on Sunday. Yes, there was the $50,000 per person fundraiser at the humble seaside cottage of billionaire industrialist David Koch, with protesters storming the beach amid the Beamers and Porsches, chanting and carrying a big banner that read, "Mitt Romney has a Koch problem." But it was those occupying the Range Rovers awaiting entry to the exclusive event who offered some of the most arresting and boldly transparent statements. Like one anonymous Romney patron who spoke to the LA Times, quote, "I don't think the common person is getting it. We've got the message. But my college kid, the babysitters, the nails ladies, everybody who's got the right to vote, they don't understand what's going on. I just think if you're lower income, one, you're not as educated, two, they don't understand how it works." And somewhere, a nails lady is prepping an exfoliator and a cuticle stick for revenge. NBC's Kristen Welker joins us live now from the White House. Kristen, the president was absolutely clear that extending these tax cuts for those making less than $250,000 means that 98% of citizens and 97% of small business owners would qualify. So does this mean that a bill is likely to be brought before the Senate or the House in the near future?
Well, Martin, good afternoon. I just spoke with Democratic aides on the Hill who say they do actually anticipate the Majority Leader Reid will bring this bill to the Senate floor. But that's about as far as it's going to go, because when you speak to Republicans, when you speak to Republicans in the House, they say they are not going to bring this bill to the floor. They cite those numbers, the 97% of businesses that would be impacted by this, and they say they agree with that number. However, they say 940,000 small businesses would still see an increase in their taxes. So they are painting this as an increase on small businesses. They say the bill that they will bring to the House floor will extend the Bush-era tax cuts for all Americans. White House Press Secretary Jay Carney was asked about that today. He was pretty firm about the fact that the president would veto such a bill. So, Martin, this is gearing up to be an election year battle, and it doesn't look like a lot of legislation is going to get passed.
There's a surprise. NBC's Kristen Welker, thank you so much. Let's get right to our panel now. In here in New York, MSNBC political analyst Joan Walsh, who's an editor-at-large for Salon.com. In Minneapolis, Anna Marie Cox, correspondent for The Guardian. And at the White House, MSNBC contributor Jonathan Capehart, who's an opinion writer for The Washington Post and whose microphone is being put on him even as I speak. They're sharing a camera, I should say, or he is, with Kristen. Joan, I have to begin with you. Your column today lays out an exquisite contrast between this extraordinary event on Sunday, or series of events, and then the president today standing up for 98% of Americans.
Right.
Is that the kind of optics that the president was seeking to play today?
It's perfect. It was perfect for him, Martin. I mean, seriously, if I wrote a script for, say, Bill Burton at Priorities USA, the pro-Obama super PAC, and I had that woman say the common people don't get it and talk dismissively about the nail ladies, he would tell me...
And the babysitters.
And the babysitters, and the lower educated people, who, the income people who aren't very educated. He would tell me to take that script somewhere else because it would be over the top. It would be too much. But that is what was said. And you had other ridiculous things being said. And you just had the Range Rovers and the Ferraris and the Rolls Royces and people shouting out, we are VIP. It was a tableau of the Romney electorate. And it's a tableau of the people that he will work for as president.
And the contrast today with the president standing up for 98%.
Right. And just the way he does with those people in the background sharing stories, admitting that he's rich. He's a rich guy now. He doesn't deserve this tax cut. Personalizing it the way he did. I mean, this is what the campaign is going to come down to. I think it was a very good day for the president.
Okay. But Anna Marie, we should give Mitt Romney credit, shouldn't we? Because with the higher reaches of the Bush tax cuts, he really is fighting to protect the top 2% of earners now, isn't he? So he's expanding his base a little. I mean, you have to agree.
Yes, of course. I think Mitt Romney may be aware of that, maybe not. You know, he's having some trouble remembering his tax returns and what he did exactly. I do think it's important to point out here that even if the Obama plan goes through, it's not like we're going to be doing a lot for income inequality in America, which has been increasing since the 70s and continued to increase under Clinton. But no one wants to talk about that part of the argument.
Indeed. John, do you think Republicans realize that Grover Norquist has led them out on a limb here? Because a Bloomberg poll last fall found that almost 7 in 10 Americans favor raising taxes on those earning more than a quarter million. Even 54% of Republicans support it.
Right, but you have a bunch of people on Capitol Hill who are enthralled to Grover Norquist, who are afraid of a primary challenge coming from the right. And a lot of people on the Hill are already far right, so you can only imagine the kind of primary challenge they would get if they did not, you know, adhere to the Grover Norquist pledge to never raise taxes ever at any point. And the other thing, Martin, to keep in mind, the president is trying to keep the middle class tax cuts in place. And one of the reasons why, you know, he wants to do that, one, is to, you know, bring relief to the middle class. But also, this was all caught up in the conversation about reducing the deficit. If you look at the total cost of those Bush tax cuts for everyone, you could pretty much wipe out a good chunk of the $12 trillion deficit that this country has.
Indeed. Joan, Romney is hitting the president for not understanding how the private economy works. Take a listen to this piece of sound first.
Do you believe that the president really understands the economy from the private sector position?
You know, I'm afraid the president, having never had a job in the private economy, just doesn't understand the kind of difficulty it is to start a business, to grow a business, to decide to hire people, to bring them on board and to train them, to take the risk associated with expanding an enterprise.
Okay, now, just for a moment, Joan, there's something important missing, because I want you to take a listen to something he said just last month.
Of course he's out of touch. He's out of touch in part because he never had the experience of working in the private sector and seeing what it takes to start a small business, how a business decides to grow, when they decide to shrink, when they decide to send jobs overseas. He doesn't understand that.
Now he's no longer saying that the president doesn't know when to ship jobs overseas. So I guess he is learning something.
He's learning something. But you know, the president's got to welcome this, Martin, that it's coming back to the issue of I have this private sector experience. That brings it back to Bain Capital. That brings it back to all the messaging about Bain's offshoring, outsourcing. It brings it back to the ways that Mitt Romney made his millions. And that's a good place for the president. You know, we had this scene of weak-kneed Democrats a couple months ago undercutting the president and saying, stay away from Bain. But we're seeing that in the swing states, these messages about the way he made his money, about Bain Capital, and about offshoring really resonate with voters. So if Mitt Romney's going to go back to that as his argument, that I know how to create jobs because I've been in the private sector, that brings the president back to Bain, and that's a great debate for him.
Anna Marie, do you agree with that, that actually this territory is now favorable for the president because Mitt Romney is such a mystery, not just with his own personal financial investments and activities, but also because when he talks about himself as a job creator, that whole story has now been somewhat sullied because there was no job creation, there was wealth creation.
I totally agree, actually. I think that maybe we're going to see something happen with the Romney campaign where it just starts to feel like a disaster. I remember covering the Kerry campaign in 2004, and there was just sort of this sense that things were going wrong and you couldn't quite stop it because the narrative got away from people. And I think that's what we're seeing right now. I mean, this what happened during his vacation is just mind-blowingly appropriate if you want to paint him as an out-of-touch rich guy. I mean, you couldn't script it better, like Joan said.
Absolutely. Anna Marie Cox, Jonathan Capehart, and Joan Walsh, stay with us. You're too good to let go. Next, why are Republicans so upset about calls for Mitt's tax returns? Maybe because it's working. Stay with us.
Nobody knows why he has a corporation in Bermuda, why he failed to disclose that on 7 different financial disclosures, why he transferred it to somebody else's purview the day before he became governor of Massachusetts.